Harper Audio presents Promise, a novel by Minrose Gwin, read by Adenrele Ojo. The Other Storm Story. Author's Note. A few minutes after 9 p.m. on Palm Sunday, April 5, 1936, a massive funnel cloud flashing a giant fireball and roaring like a runaway train careened into the thriving cotton mill town of Tupelo in northeastern Mississippi. The tornado was measured as an F5, the highest level on the Fujita scale. Winds were estimated at 261 to 318 miles per hour, leveling 48 city blocks, about half the town. The Tupelo tornado wreaked havoc. The dead and dying were strewn about the town, dangling in the sheared limbs of leafless trees, buried under debris, pinned to the bottom of a small lake called Gum Pond, laid out in alleyways and makeshift morgues. Members of a family of 13, including a newborn baby, were blown in all directions. None survived. My grandmother found a dead baby girl in a crepe myrtle bush and wrapped her in a dish towel and laid her on the kitchen counter. There are at least 5 published accounts of flying children, including a girl around 8 years old who was blown from her own home on the black side of town, miraculously sailing through a window and landing dazed but unhurt in the attic of a white family a mile away. Featherless chickens and hornless steers wandered the city streets. Debris from Tupelo was found in the neighboring state of Tennessee. The official death toll ranged from 216 to 233. Between 700 and 1,000 townspeople were listed as injured, many of them having lost limbs. Based on these figures, the Tupelo tornado of 1936 remains today the 4th most deadly tornado in the history of the United States. Growing up in my grandparents' sturdy 4-square house, one of the few left standing on their side of town, I heard these stories and many more. I thought I knew everything there was to know, truth or lore, about the Tupelo tornado of 1936. I was wrong. What I did not know was that the casualty records for the Tupelo tornado were incomplete and therefore inaccurate. Members of the African American community, 1/3 of the town's population, many of whom lived in ramshackle housing on a northeastern ridge called the Hill, were quite simply not counted. The death and injury tolls were much higher than records show. We will never know those numbers. We will never know the names of all the uncounted. A story can sometimes tread where history fails to clear a path, or when that path has been made too tidy, obscuring a fractured landscape. It is that fractured landscape that I've tried to decipher in this work of fiction. Events and place names in this story of the Tupelo tornado and its immediate aftermath are from newspaper accounts, oral narratives, and memorabilia. The characters and their stories are entirely fictitious. Palm Sunday, April 5th, 1936. 1. 8 p.m. Too still out there. Dark coming on and no birds singing goodnight, lady. No squirrels rummaging for last year's acorns under the big oak out front. The sky bruised, yellow and green with streaks of plum. Peculiar smell in the air, too. Sour, vinegary. Downright peculiar. She knew it but couldn't place it. Something to eat, maybe? But what? Now the wind kicked up in wicked little bursts. Rain or worse. Maybe hail. And there it all was, an entire day's work, flapping on the line like some big white fell from the sky bird. The McNab wash. Sheets, towels, underwear, diapers, what have you. One sheet wrapped around the line snagged. The judge's upside-down dress shirts white as the driven snow, that much less skin on her knuckles. Her fingertips still burned, slick from the bleach. She stood on her tiptoes and peered out the window over the kitchen sink. Her neck rose in cords above the buttoned collar of her wash dress, which was pocked with pools and stains and gaping where the button under her breasts had long since popped off and been lost. She wiped her hands down the sides of her dress to dry them and touched her head the way she used to do when she was little and her people got around the table and started telling about how she came into the world with a little cap of hair that looked for all the world like the feathers of a baby bird. She'd had trouble catching her first few breaths, and so was a grayish color when her father first saw her. He called her his dovey, insisted on the name. Her mother had sat straight up in bed, labor sweat still wet on her face. Naming her firstborn after a bird? What you going to name the next one, she'd asked. Pigeon? Crow? But Dovey had always liked her name. When she was a girl, she studied doves, the maternal bulk of their bodies, the way they bobbed their small heads and cooed full-throatedly and stayed low to the ground. How they fussed when she got too near and flushed them. They seemed to her more human than other birds, more willing to stay close, less afraid of a human hand, downright companionable. Sometimes now on winter nights, when she slept deep and still under a pile of quilts, she dreamed she was one. She fluttered on the edge of something brown and warm, and then, cooing, she flapped her arms, and then, oh glory, she took off into the wide blue yonder, riding the wind. Up Main Street, past Crosstown where the two train tracks made an X like a bullseye in the middle of town, over the churches and steeples, the fancy columned houses up and down Church Street, Peggy's Funeral Home, TKE Drugstore, People's Bank and Trust, Reed's and Black's Department Stores, White Town. Then to the southeast, Milltown, a different set of white folks. Skinny as rails and so paper thin white, they looked like you could poke a finger through them. They lived in rolled-up shotguns that sagged and leaned like a stack of dominoes about to go over. They worked 12 hours a day, 6 days a week at the mill, even the children, who were scrawnier than any black child up on the hill or even down in Shake Rag. Looked like they'd never sat down to a meal of fatback and greens and cornbread. Wormy. Then she would turn back north, swoop and flutter up Green Street, rising with the landscape toward home. Elephant Hill, where her own people lived. She wasn't sure why they called it that. Some called it Park Hill. But the hill it was. A humped bluff overlooking muddy gum pond, also called Park Lake. Perched on top, Carver High, Springfield Cemetery, the faded old school bus where the Davises packed in three large children and a pair of twin babies. St. John the Baptist Church, J.W. Porter Undertaker. Houses that snaked in all directions, having been built onto bit by bit as they filled up with babies and old folks to take care of. Lucille Jones's garden with its splash of daylilies and black-eyed Susans. At the highest point, the water tower, a monster on stilts, cast a shadow over the whole community. Now it was coming on dark, sure enough. Out beyond the wash on the line to the southwest side of North Green, where the paved street turned to rutted dirt, stretched Glenwood Cemetery, the chalky gravestones bent over like the broken down, mostly old white people who now rested beneath them. To the east, Gum Pond, swampy and crawling with muskrats and snakes, not to speak of all manner of no-count lowlifes, black and white, hanging around out there under those big gum trees all hours of the day and night, smoking that Mexican hemp they sold up at Blue Mountain, up to no possible good. And back to the north, Spring Hill Cemetery, where her mother and daddy lay with Janesy and Aldine in blue. Her whole family long gone from the typhoid, leaving her an orphan at 8. Forced to live with an aunt who put her to work at the washboard, where she'd been ever since. That afternoon when the wash was done, she'd walked over to Spring Hill, her white head rag bobbing up and down over the high ridge and rolling hills, over the indentions where the graves marked and unmarked lay. She sat down next to her family, all 5 of them there together in an impossibly small piece of ground. The late day sun flooded the western ridge in gold and turned the grass and moss to green velvet. The sun's rays came in over the graves like the points of a spear, showing up the telltale scallops in the ground where each grave had been dug. When it reached her lap, it fired the faded roses on her house dress to hot coals. There was an old cedar tree at the top of the ridge. Next to it, an old man's sycamore bent eastward from years of wind. She pushed herself backward into their shade, sweating a little. Her dead ones, were they at peace? Hadn't they wanted more of this dear, sweet earth? The smells, the bird calls, the way the light turned slant in the fall? Hadn't they wanted all that? There was a place in the cemetery where she didn't go. A far corner backed up to some scrub pines. The small stone she and Virgil had bought now mottled with moss and mold, covered over in pine needles and broken branches. There was a disturbance in the needles. Some animal had made its bed there. Now, as she stood at the kitchen sink, that old whistle shattered the odd quieter than quiet, making her jump. Once, twice, 3, 4, 5 times. The 8 o'clock M&O, its tracks to the northeast, just the other side of Gum Pond. When she was a girl, after she'd lost her family, she used to lie in bed and listen for the 8 o'clock, her little chest a turtle's shell grown hard from the slow crawl of grief. Now she felt the old rumble in her throat, something between a growl and a song that came from a low place, calling back to the train, saying she was sad, sad. She wanted her brother and sisters back. Saying what that McNabb boy did to her dreamer deserved a killing. She would relish it. But how to kill a white man? Well, poison for one thing. Was there a poison a person might use on clothes? Sprinkle it on like starch and 1, 2, 3, boogeyman's dead as meat and nobody knows why? Huh. Dovey didn't study white folks unless forced to. Bad enough dealing with their peculiar odors and stains that lingered on sheets and handkerchiefs and underwear. Did they ever bathe? Bad enough the scrubbing and bleaching those stains out, only to have them returned to you the next week, nastier than ever. But what that devil did to Dreema was like a tiger sashaying through the front door. You couldn't not study it, or it would eat you alive. She and Virgil had gone to the sheriff and then to the boy's daddy, the judge. Nothing was done. Nor she knew in the pit of her stomach would it ever be. White folks being white folks. It would have to be the McNabb's laundry out there. She couldn't help herself. She flat out detested the whole family, even the little baby, which she knew was wrong, wrong, wrong. But she couldn't help herself. She knew the McNabbs in the most intimate ways, in ways they did not know one another. She knew that the Mrs. had not once ceased to bleed since that baby was born 4 months ago, that she perspired so much she wore underarm pads with even her everyday dresses. She knew the girl had broken her left arm. The left sleeve of several of her blouses had been cut off and hemmed. She knew the judge ate tomato salad every Thursday at TKE Drugs because he splattered it all over his white shirt. She knew that boy didn't keep himself clean in the private ways a decent person should, which didn't surprise her in the least. He was lower than low. At the sink, she shifted from one foot to the other. Her feet, tiny and swollen and gnarled as the bark of an old tree trunk. Her legs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.